Hello, this is Kevin Smith, the pastor of Sanders Chapel United Methodist Church, Cooley United Methodist Church, and First United Methodist Church of Winfield, Louisiana. And today I have for you the message and the service that was intended for May 10th of 2020. Of course, we cannot gather together physically because of the virus pandemic that has affected Louisiana, our country, and all over the world. And so I am speaking to empty pews at First United Methodist Church of Winfield today, but I know that you are behind that camera. And so I hope and pray that this will be God's message to you. As we begin, there's a few things I want to remind you of. First, in the description, you will find some traditional hymns as well as some contemporary songs to go with our message today from 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 18 through 25. And so I hope you will take a minute to look at those and to worship God, not only with the spoken word, but also through music. And I hope that those will be helpful to you. Second, as the work of the church continues, so have our expenses. So we'd like to invite you to continue to support us as you are able. If you would like to give to First United Methodist Church of Winfield, you can go to our website, which is fumcwinfield.com, and click on the Give button, and that will take you to our online giving page. You can also text all one word, FUMCWinfield, to 22525, and it will text you back a link to go to that giving page if you would like to go there directly. Or you can send us a check in the mail to P.O. Box 510, Winfield, Louisiana 71483. If you would like to give to Cooley United Methodist Church, you can direct your gifts to Fran Bernard. And if you would like to give to Sanders Chapel United Methodist Church, direct your gifts to Marilyn Monroe. We want to say how much we appreciate your support, your words of encouragement. This has been a difficult time for all of us, and we never imagined a time where we couldn't gather in the church together, but that day has come. And so hopefully the day will also come when we can gather together again, even though it might look very different in the future than it has looked in the past. And so we hope and pray that that day is not that far away. In the meantime, we want you to know that we love you, we care for you, we're praying for you, and we want you to just encourage you to hang in there, that God is with you, and we are too, and we hope and pray that this time today will be an encouragement to you. Now, Sunday, May 10th of 2020 is scheduled to be Mother's Day in the United States, and we usually recognize and honor our mothers, but of course we can't do that today because we can't physically gather together. And so I asked our congregations at Sanders Chapel, at Cooley, and at First United Methodist Church of Winfield to send me pictures of their mothers so that we could create a slideshow. And to be honest, it was the first time we've ever done something like that. I wasn't sure what kind of response we would get. I thought maybe we'd be doing good if we got 25 pictures or 30 pictures. Instead, I got over 50 pictures of moms that made an impact on your life. And so I have prepared this slideshow. Our pianist, Fran Walton, has provided the music. And we hope and pray it will be meaningful to you as we remember and celebrate our moms. Now, these pictures, they don't have names for a couple of reasons. First, I was just too afraid that I would misspell the name or get it wrong or put the wrong name with the wrong picture or something of that nature. So if you would like to tell us where your mom is located in the comments, give us the minute and the second stamp, and you can tell us her name and a little bit about what she means to you. If you'd like to do that, that would certainly be wonderful to tell us who your mom is and what she meant to you. Also, I was a little bit concerned about privacy concerns since this is going on the internet for all to see. And so I wanted to be mindful of that also. But we do want to say happy Mother's Day to all of our moms. We want to say thank you for the impact that you've made on our lives. And we hope and we pray that this slideshow will be meaningful to you. God bless you, mothers. Thank you for all that you do. Thank you. Wasn't that amazing and wonderful? Thank you to everyone who submitted pictures. And for those of you that didn't, I know that your mom made an impact on your life. And so I hope that you will call her today if she is still on this side of heaven, or maybe offer a prayer on her behalf to God, just thanking God for the impact that she's made on your life. And so even as we celebrate Mother's Day, we know that it is not necessarily a good day for some, that maybe there are some who want to be moms and cannot. Maybe there are some moms who are separated from their children because for many different reasons, or maybe you didn't have the best relationship with your mother. But we want you to know that there is someone who loves and cares for you, and that is God. And so God is always there for us. We also probably have had those women in our lives who have mothered us, even if it was not our physical mother. Maybe it was a teacher or a Sunday school teacher or a mentor or some of those folks. And so we can give God thanks for those folks, even if Mother's Day is not the best day for us. And so let's begin with a word of prayer. Oh Lord, we are so grateful for our mothers and for all that they've taught us, for the impact that they have made on our lives. Lord, they are truly a gift from you, and we are so grateful. Lord, on this day, we also remember so many for whom this is not a good day. Lord, we pray for those who want to be mothers and are not, for those who are separated from their moms or maybe separated from their children. Lord, for others who maybe didn't have the best relationship with their mother, Lord, we pray for them also on this day, and we ask that you would fill in that hurt and that pain with your love and your care. For Lord, we know that you have promised to never leave us or forsake us. But Lord, we also know that you have called us to walk in your steps and to live in a certain way as we seek to follow Jesus. And so as we hear your message today from 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 18 through 25, we hope and pray that we would take these words to heart, and we hope and pray that you would help us to walk in your steps each and every day so that others will see Jesus in us through the things that we do and say. Lord, as we gather in your house today, as we worship you online, Lord, we know that you are with us. We know that you have promised to never leave us or forsake us. We do pray for so many that are ill, for some that are maybe ill with the virus, maybe ill with another illness, or maybe waiting surgery coming up as elective procedures have returned to us in Louisiana this week. Lord, we pray your healing touch to be upon them. We pray for your strength and your help. And Lord, we continue to pray for our health professionals and doctors and nurses who are on the front lines of this thing. We ask your protection to be with them. Lord, we pray also for those who have lost a loved one to death, maybe to the virus or maybe some other way. Lord, we know that you have promised to be close to the brokenhearted, and so we ask that you would surround them with your comfort and your peace, and that they would know your love. And so, Lord, as we worship you today, we pray that your Holy Spirit would come into our hearts and lives. And Lord, that you would speak through these words, and that you would touch us with your Holy Spirit and draw us closer to you. Now, Lord, most of all, we are grateful for your Son, Jesus Christ. And it is all these things we pray in his name, as he taught his disciples to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As I have mentioned, our scripture today is from 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 18 through 25, and the message title is In His Steps, In His Steps. So I invite you to hear the word of the Lord wherever you are today. Slaves, accept the authority of your masters with all deference, not only those who are kind and gentle, but also those who are harsh. For it is a credit to you if, being aware of God, you endure pain while suffering unjustly. If you endure when you are beaten for doing wrong, what credit is that? But if you endure when you do right and suffer for it, you have God's approval. For to this you have been called, because Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example, so that you should follow in his steps. He committed no sin, and no deceit was found in his mouth. When he was abused, he did not return abuse. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but he entrusted himself to the one who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross, so that free from sins, we might live for righteousness. By his wounds, you have been healed. For you were going astray like sheep, but now you have returned to the shepherd and guardian of your souls. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. This book, written in 1896 by Charles Sheldon and titled In His Steps, has sold over 50 million copies and ranks as one of the best-selling books of all times. The title for the book and the topic of the opening chapter comes from a scripture from our reading today from 1 Peter. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 21. For to this you have been called, because Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example, so that you should follow in his steps. And In His Steps is the story of a somewhat complacent congregation that commits itself to living for 1 year with the constant question, what would Jesus do? And the reason that question arises is that they had a tramp walk into their Sunday morning service and to talk with them and ask them, what does faith really mean if it doesn't make a difference in the way that we act? Well, because of his illness, the tramp died, and the congregation committed themselves to ask the question, what would Jesus do? They did it for an entire year, and the book chronicles the challenges and the successes of asking that question and following through with the ways that we live. The congregation stayed true to their commitment, and in the end, they have a powerful influence on their families and their community. In His Steps is still in publication today and is considered to be one of the most read books in the entire world. But it is a haunting question. What would Jesus do if he were in our place, facing the dilemmas and challenges that you and I face every day? Now, some people think it is a silly question. It's impossible, they say, to know what Jesus would do in every situation. And of course, they're right. We are not Christ. Our logic can never be his logic, and yet it is not a silly question. In fact, the writer of 1 Peter gives us some guidelines as how we might live as Jesus lived and walk in his steps. Now, you might have noticed that the passage begins with instructions to slaves, which might offend our modern sensibilities in the 21st century. But it seems that at least some of the people that Peter was writing to were slaves, and so he gives them this specific instructions. Now, in the late first century AD, when the early Christian church spread from Jerusalem and Palestine into the Roman Empire, a great percentage of the church was likely slaves. In the ancient world, slaves could be any race or any gender, that they were a legal commodity bought and sold like any other trade good. Some people were born into slavery, others were captured during war, some sold themselves into slavery voluntarily in order to pay their debts. So Peter's instructions to slaves this morning is in the middle of his guidance about how groups of Christians are to conduct themselves and how they are to live in the world. Now, the giant institution of slavery in the Roman Empire and how long it had operated, it should not shock us that no one in the New Testament says that slavery is wrong. A Christian slave revolt at that time would have gotten many people killed and probably would have doomed the church to extinction within the Roman Empire. So Peter advises slaves to do something less than revolt. Instead, he tells them the behaviors and attitudes that they are to practice. And his advice centers on following Jesus, that Jesus lived as a servant and died a slave's death. Peter writes, "Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example." Now, this word example is a very interesting word in the original Greek language. It was either letters in which children would fill in an outline drawn by a teacher, or it was letters on a wax tablet that the children would trace in order to learn their alphabet. And so this is the kind of example that Jesus provides for us, that we should live just like him. And Peter writes, "To this you were called because Christ suffered for you, leaving you an example that you should follow in his steps." Christ has set us an example. We are to walk in his steps. But how do we know what Christ would do? And so I invite you to hear some ideas of that Peter gives his readers about what it might look like for us to walk in the steps of Jesus. First, we should live a life of integrity. We should live a life of integrity. Peter writes in verse 22, "He committed no sin and no deceit was found in his mouth." If Jesus said it, then you knew it was true. You could take it to the bank. He walked his walk, as we might say today. He walked his talk. Other people might say one thing and mean another, but Jesus was not that way. What you saw was what you got. Don't we need that today? How many people do you and I know who say one thing and do something else? Why, if we were brutally honest, we would probably have to admit that there are times when we have done it ourselves, even with the best of intentions. But Peter says that Jesus wasn't like that, that no deceit was found in his mouth. He lived a life of integrity. A man named Jim Stovall wrote a book titled, "You Don't Have to Be Blind to See." Jim was just a boy when a condition called juvenile macular degeneration began to steal away his eyesight. By the time he reached adulthood, Jim was totally blind. But Jim never let his blindness keep him from living as normal a life as possible. He even attended college, even though he had to work much harder than the average student. After a late night of studying, Jim often took a break by walking through the dorm. Sometimes he would stop and visit with the dorm maintenance man, a fellow by the name of Jimmy Carter, no relation to the former president. Jimmy Carter, the maintenance man, he took great pride in his work and he expected those around him to do their very best also. And so he often asked Jim, "Are you squared away?" By that he meant, "Are you ready for this term paper? Have you studied hard enough? Are you giving it your best effort?" Well, one day Jimmy Carter surprised Jim by inviting him into his supply room. The walls were plastered with photos of past students. Carter proudly pointed out certain young men and announced how successful that they were. Some were bankers or lawyers. Some were professors or preachers. All were successful in the eyes of Jimmy Carter. Then he remarked to Jim, "They were no better or worse than you. They just got themselves squared away." Well, Jim Stovall went on to excel in college. He graduated with the highest honors. He became a successful stockbroker and then started his own television network. Today, Jim's network is carried by thousands of cable stations all over the world. It has won an Emmy in addition to other awards and honors. And Jim travels the country as a successful motivational speaker. Many years after Jim graduated from college, he made a visit to the local nursing home, and he ran into his old friend, Jimmy Carter. They talked for a while, and then the nurse took the former maintenance man back to his room. But as she turned to go, the nurse mentioned to Jim, "You made it onto his wall." With all of the awards and all of the honors and all of the achievements that Jim Stovall has earned, he says that nothing else compares to the knowledge that his picture hangs on Jimmy Carter's wall. You see, the question that Jimmy Carter asked Jim Stovall is one that you and I need to ask. Are we squared away? Do we have our lives in order? Do our values drive what we do each and every day? 1 Peter tells us that Jesus committed no sin and no deceit was found in his mouth. He lived a life of integrity. Secondly, Peter says that we have to know how to handle adversity if we are to walk in his steps. We must know how to handle adversity. I sure wish that I could tell you that when we became believers and disciples and followers of Jesus, that our lives would always go smoothly and we would never have any problems or adversity in our lives. And maybe there are some preachers that would say that. I am not one of them. I have faced adversity, and I know that you have too. I know some of the trouble that you have been through, and I know that I have faced some of those same challenges. And it's interesting that Jesus himself, the Son of God, the creator of the universe, he also faced adversity, sometimes even worse than what we faced. After all, he was crucified. And so if Jesus faced trouble, why should we not expect to face trouble also? But 1 Peter tells us that Jesus knew how to handle adversity in tough times. We read in verse 23, "When they hurled their insults at him, he did not retaliate. When he suffered, he made no threats." Now you and I probably would not have reacted like that when they drove nails in our wrists and in our feet. We would not have responded as Christ responded when they taunted him as he hung on the cross. But Jesus knew how to handle adversity and tough times. One of the great determinants in how successfully we will live is how we handle trouble and adversity. John Marks Templeton tells about a men's therapy support group that met in the evenings. The moderator of the group explained that they would go around the circle and each man would take a few moments to explain what wasn't working in his life. Then each man was to add what they would do to change it. As they continued around the circle, the last person in the circle was a handsome young man about 20 years old. "My friends," the young man said almost wistfully when it came his turn, "I have been diagnosed with terminal cancer." The gasp was audible in the room. "My doctors have given me 3 to 6 months to live. I have struggled with this for a month now and have finally made a decision." His voice gained confidence as it grew, and he said, "I am going to take up flying lessons." "Flying lessons?" "I have decided to live," replied the young man. The boy was dying. He would not even get a chance to live his life. And yet, here he was with a look of triumph, a look of joy, because he was going to take flying lessons. And he was going to choose to live while he was alive. When the other men around the circle left that night, they had also taken up the torch of believing in their own lives. They had seen the fight in another. They had seen the positive outlook in someone else. And it reminded them that they had a choice about how they would face the troubles in their own lives. You see, this young man, he knew how to handle adversity, and so did Jesus. What would Jesus do, we might ask? Well, he would live his life with integrity. He would face adversity with faith. And there was a reason. Peter tells us when they hurled their insults at him, he did not retaliate. When he suffered, he made no threats. Instead, Peter writes, he entrusted himself to him who judges justly. Jesus knew how to handle adversity. The last thing I want you to see is that we must trust God. We must trust God if we are to live like Jesus. Jesus trusted God, and so he could live with integrity. He trusted God, and that's how he could face adversity. That's how he could forgive his enemies, even as he was on the cross. Peter writes in verse 23, he entrusted himself to him who judges justly. If you and I are going to walk in Jesus' steps, here is what we must do. We must trust God in the good times and in the not so good times. Peter holds Jesus before us. He says, Christ suffered for you. Verse 25 tells us that we were going astray like sheep, and Jesus brought us into the fold at the cost of his own life and included us in the family of God by his suffering. Jesus now gives us the ability to choose how we respond to our trouble, as Peter instructs the Christian slaves to accomplish something with their suffering, to instead of respond in kind, respond like Jesus in love. He allows these Christian slaves to put some meaning and some progress with their suffering, to put it to good purpose, just as Jesus did. An unknown author has made a list called Our Thinking Versus God's Promises. I want to share it with you today. We think it's impossible. God says all things are possible in Luke chapter 18, verse 27. We think I'm too tired. God says I will give you rest in Matthew 11, 28 through 30. We think nobody really loves me. God says I love you. In John 3:16 and John 13:34. We think I can't go on. God says my grace is sufficient for you in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 9. We think I can't figure things out. God says I will direct your steps in Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 through 6. We think I can't do it. But God says you can do all things in Philippians chapter 4, verse 13. We think I'm not able. God says I am able in 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 8. We think it's not worth it. God says it will be worth it in Romans chapter 8, verse 28. We think I can't forgive myself. God says I forgive you. In 1 John chapter 1, verse 9. We think I can't manage all of this. God says I will supply all of your needs. In Philippians chapter 4, verse 19. We think I'm afraid. God says I have not given you a spirit of fear. In 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 7. We think I'm always worried and frustrated. God says cast all your cares on me. in 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 7. We think, I don't have enough faith. God says, I've given everyone a measure of faith in Romans chapter 12, verse 3. We think, I'm not smart enough. God says, I will give you wisdom in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 30. We think, I feel all alone. God says, I will never leave you or forsake you in Hebrews chapter 13, verse 5. So no matter our circumstances, we can trust God. And so these are God's promises to us. Do you believe them? Will you walk in His steps? To do so, we must live with integrity. We must deal with adversity like Jesus. We must ask ourselves, what would Jesus do? And we know that the answer would be that Jesus would trust God. And so, let us walk in His steps. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. It has been good to have you with us today. I hope this has touched your heart. In the description, you will find a link to where you can read In His Steps for free, an electronic version. It's also widely available in print if you would like to rent it from your borrow it from your local library. I've also linked several movies based on the book, one in 1964 and one that's only been out a few months that was done in 2019, a more modern retelling of the story. I think you would find it meaningful. It's a great little book, and I hope that you'll take some time to read it. We pray that this service has been meaningful to you. We know that it is a challenge to maintain and to keep our faith going. And so I hope and pray that God would be with you in this time, that you would know His presence, that you would know the Holy Spirit within you, and that you would walk in His steps as we seek to follow Jesus. We want you to know that we love you, we care for you, we're praying for you, and we hope and pray that God would lead you and guide you. Have a good day. We'll talk to you later. God bless you.